Thank you, Grant. Thank you, Betty. Welcome, everybody, to our November Tea Party meeting. I just want to cover a few bases real quick. Most of you already know, but most of these meetings wind up on YouTube. If you go to YouTube and type in Pocono Tea Party, that's the name of the channel. There's probably about 30, 40 videos up there, past speakers. So you can review past meetings and learn there. And there's always a place to comment as well. I do want to take the opportunity to wish everyone a happy and blessed Thanksgiving. It's just one of those wonderful holidays that only America seems to mark a day on the calendar and say, all right, everyone stop and thank God today. Take a moment, bend a knee, and spend time with our Creator. It's a wonderful thing. Our guest tonight is Mark Abedrabbo, who I met, close to 2 years ago. We were on different sides of the campaign season, but his candidate did a lot better than my candidate, so that speaks well of him. But getting to know him since that time, I thought it would be good to have someone come and speak on a subject that's in the news these days so much. The Syrian refugee crisis, of course, is awful, what is happening. But we are a nation of laws, and I think we need guidance on who to open the gates to. So our speaker tonight is someone that was raised a Muslim, but got to know Christ our Savior, and gave his heart to him, praise God. And was raised in the culture of Palestine, of Arabia. So I thought it would be nice to hear just a fresh perspective that we don't get to hear every day here in the Poconos. Now he's private business owner here in the Poconos, and you know how that'll turn you into conservative pretty quickly with the taxes and regulations. And he's been active in campaigns in New Jersey that he's run in the past, and a great help here in the Poconos to candidates. So with that, would you please welcome Mark Abedrabbo.
Good evening, everybody. All right, there we go. Thank you, Pete, for that. Thank you for the opportunity tonight to be here. I haven't been in a setting like this in probably a long time. So if I become nervous, I'm sorry. And just want to open. Huh?
We're friendly.
Thank you for showing up. Can I just open up with a prayer as well? Dear God, just ask you to forgive us for any of our sins, God. And we just come before you tonight, and we lay this meeting in your hands, God. Thank you for your blessing upon our lives and this town, God. Thank you for helping us and giving us wisdom, Holy Spirit, to speak the truth, and we just thank you for your blessing over tonight, in Jesus' name.
Amen. God bless America.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, God bless America, too. A little awkward, but all right. Well, I'm just going to start a little bit with my background. You know where I'm from. I
was born in New Jersey, Ridgewood, Bergen County. And my mother was from Brooklyn. She's Italian-Irish. My dad was from Jerusalem, and he's Palestinian. He was an Arab Muslim. And I was born Muslim by no choice. I had no choice in the matter. So thank God for free will and choice when we become to a place in our lives that we need to make choices. And unfortunately, you know, you look at life right now, what's going on around us, you know, and the wars and the, you know, and the conflict, you know, it's a little overwhelming, you know, very overwhelming. You know, my heart goes out to just the people that are suffering, you know, the families that you know, lost their loved ones in Paris, and you know, that was just a pretty heart-reckoning, you know, thing to think about, you know. So, but you know, it's what's going on is you have all these refugees. You know, I was in Jordan in 2005 when we went to war with Iraq. And I saw that epidemic when the Iraqis were leaving, the refugees were leaving, you know, Iraq, and they were going into Jordan. I was in Jordan, and I went to visit Israel, and it was, you know, people living on the streets, and you know, it's sad. It's a sad situation when you know, when we face and we have epidemics like this and tragedies like this. It's really sad, you know. And I just, my heart, you know, wanted to just speak about that, you know. So being a Muslim for 34 years, I'm Arab American. I went to Catholic school as a Muslim. Okay, that's pretty messed up. Okay, you know, I got beat by the nuns. And I'm okay though. I made it to tell the story, you know? So, you know, my dad, growing up as an Arab American here in the United States was and being Muslim was pretty difficult. I moved from the city of Paterson, New Jersey, which is predominantly Arab. They own probably pretty much the whole city. That whole area, Patterson, Hackensack, you know, there's a lot of Arabs down there. My family owns like all Main Street. So, you know, if you could need a good deal on some airline tickets or Syrian food, Lebanese food. So growing up in the city, we moved to Columbia, New Jersey. I don't know if you all know where that is, right across the river, Columbia. So we moved to Columbia, and when I went to school there, you know, I was probably the only Arab in the entire school. They didn't even know what Arabic was. Okay, they're like, Muslim? Are you from another planet? You know, it was really hard. You know, I mean, so growing up as a Sunni Muslim, you know, there's different sects of the Muslim religion. There's the Sunnis, which right now, if you see all Syria, they're predominantly Sunnis. The Syrian Muslims that are migrating and becoming refugees right now to, you know, Pennsylvania are Sunni Muslims. Then you have your Shiite Muslims, and you have your Wahhabi Muslims, where you have your Kurds, your Turks, you know, which are different sects of the Muslim religion. They all believe in the same book, the Quran. They call it the Book of No Doubt. And I beg to differ, that there's a lot of doubt in that. So you have these, so it was tough growing up, tough being a Muslim in America, Arab American. You know, the Quran talks about certain things like you shouldn't even hurt a tree. You know, and Arab Americans, their view on America, like I was talking to my father last night. I had a conversation with my father. I called my father was living here. He's 60. He's going to be 70 years old. He moved here when he was 23 years old. He immigrated from Palestine. I was talking to my father last night. I said, Dad, I said, you know, what's going on with this whole ISIS thing? You know, what's happening? You know, what's going on with these wars? I says, you know, and I'm trying to get a little, like, you know, insight from my father. You know, like, he kind of knows I'm Christian, but, you know, he plays dumb. And I just play dumber, you know? So, it's like dumber and dumber, you know? So, it's good. Yeah, it's all right. So, we were talking about, you know, he wants to vote for Hillary Clinton. And I'm like, okay, here we go. So, but yeah, I was talking to him. I said, you know what, Dad? I says, you know what my father told me? An Arab American, he said, America is the best country in the world. He said that I wouldn't trade it for anything. You know? So, best country in the world, and the opportunity that it gave him, you know, he was a successful businessman, my father. It gave him an opportunity and, you know, the freedom that we have here. And I said, you know, I said, a lot of things are being taken away from us, our freedoms. And, you know, after 9/11 happened, you know, the Patriot Act, and they took away, you know, they could come in your home at any time. And, you know, there's certain liberties and, you know, things that, and, you know, it's going to get worse. It's going to get worse, you know. And I told my father this, and he said, well, you know, if you're not doing anything wrong, you have nothing to worry about. And I, you know what? I said, you know what, Dad? You're absolutely right. I said, and I kind of turned it around, and I said to my father, I said, you know, if your relationship with God is in right standing, you have nothing to be afraid of, you know? So I started preaching, but he didn't know it. I was talking to my father about ISIS. The makeup of ISIS. Who are they? How did they get so big, and how did they get so big so fast? You know, pretty scary. Who's behind it? You know, So through my life, I was searching for truth. Truth, you know, truth of the matter is that there is a truth out there. You know, we try to figure out what that truth is, and we're all searching for the truth. You know, and you know, we get wounded searching for the truth. And so in my search for my truth, you know, I being a Muslim and growing up in religion, I was really wanting to know what the truth is in this earth. What's going on here? What's the real? What's real? What's real? What's fake? So, you know, I came to a place in my life where I had to just, I was trying to find God in my life, you know. I was a devoted Muslim. I used to go to the mosque every Friday and, I really loved the Muslim religion. You know, I was an Arab American Muslim, and I wasn't a terrorist. You know, and I, you know, there's a lot of Arab American Muslims that are not terrorists. You know what I'm saying? You know, there's actually a part of the religion that's peaceful. You know, so you know, it is overwhelming though. What's happening, and you know, it keeps leading me back to one thing in my heart. And I what I need to do for myself personally is to keep my eyes on the cross. You know, that's where, you know, that's what keeps speaking to me right now. Keep my eyes on the cross, because when I take my eyes off of the cross, is when, you know, things, maybe fear could come in, and doubt and negativity and, you know, anger. So, you know, it's been a long road, and I was a Muslim until probably 34 years old. I'm 39 years old right now. Just turned 39 in July. And I became Christian in 2010. I became a Christian. I gave my heart to the Lord in 2010. It was a great thing that I did. It's been a process ever since, you know. Coming from, and I'm still Arab, you know. I'm still Arab. I have Arab in my blood, you know. And it's been a tough, you know, convert, you know, to convert over to be a Christian, because half my family's Muslim, and you know, my father told me that he was going to disown me, you know, after I told him I became a Christian. But you know, we still have a relationship today, so. You know, it's just, so that's when I became Christian. I became Christian in 2010, and it was the best thing that I ever did. And because God brought me through a lot to be here today to tell this story, to tell my testimony, to tell my conversion, you know, that we don't have to be afraid of the Syrians coming into Pennsylvania. You know, we don't have to fear that, you know, I was looking at the makeup of you know, the whole Syrian coming in and what the government wants to do and, you know, the laws they're trying to infringe on security and measures and, you know, I believe as Arab American that, you know, we should scrutinize whoever's coming into our countries. We should have security measures that probably are greater than ever before. You know, it's a problem. Homeland security is a problem. I mean, you know, I don't know if anybody read the book, Son of Hamas. The leader of the Islamic Revolution, who started the whole Islamic Revolution, was Sheikh Musab Hussein. Sheikh Hussein. And his son was Musab Hussein. He wrote a book called Son of Hamas. Well, you know, I pray for our borders every day. I pray for our borders. Nothing's changed. The enemies, you know, ISIS is growing and it's getting larger. You know, wars are gonna happen. It's in the Bible, it talks about wars and famines that are gonna happen. It's something, you know, there's gonna be troubles in this life. But you know, in 2000, and I would say probably not too long after 9/11, Musab Hussein, who was the son, was working for the PLO. He came to America on a tourist visa, and he was here for a year. And I don't know why this story is coming to me right now, but it is. And he was here for a year, and he went and he knocked on Homeland Security's door. And he said to Homeland Security, says, you have a serious problem with your security in this country, you know? And you know what they told him? You're a terrorist, or we're gonna kick you out of our country. They got offended. They said, how dare you come tell us that we have security problems. He says, listen, he fought them. He fought them, and he won. And they granted him asylum, political asylum here. You know, and the reason why I tell about his story is because he also became a Christian. And he found Jesus. He got baptized in the Pacific Ocean on YouTube after he was here. He actually took a trip back. We talk about boldness. He took a trip back to Jerusalem, and he aired on their news in Jerusalem about a movie that he was making depicting the Prophet Muhammad and the truth about who he really was. And, you know, I mean, you know, they were going to kill this guy. He went back to his own city in Jerusalem. I think his dad died. I don't know if his dad ever accepted Jesus. That's only between him and God. But he preached to his father. And you know, the thing is, the thing of the Muslims. So Now he's fighting for, you know, America. He was working for the government, this guy, Mossad Hussein. But the truth of the matter is that, you know, the Muslims are closer to Jesus, and this is what you know, than we think. They believe that Jesus is their Messiah. And I don't know if you guys ever knew that, okay? They believe Jesus never died, and he's coming back as their Messiah. They don't believe that he's God, but they believe that he's the Messiah. He's the Savior. You know, so people are like, really? That's weird, you know? And I'm Christian, and you know, I believe Jesus is Lord. I believe Jesus is the Messiah. And, you know, so, I mean, so we do definitely have security measures in our country, our borders. This has been going on since the 1991 Persian Gulf War. I mean, right? With, you know, remember Albright and Bush, and, you know, with the whole going to Kuwait and you burn all the oil things down, and I mean, and then, you know, tear the whole country up, and Afghanistan, and, you know, when you know, we pray for peace in the Middle East. I was there myself personally. As an Arab American, I've experienced profiling myself. I was pulled over and had machine guns held to me in the old city in Jerusalem. I've had, you know, been searched thoroughly. I'm an American citizen, born in America, you know. So, you know, the Muslims believe that everybody's against them. They believe that they became the new blacks. Fortunately, that's the truth. After 9/11, they believe that, you know, that they became the black people, you know, they should be thanking the Arabs, you know, after what happened in 9/11. It's you know, so we definitely need to tighten up our security screening with these refugees coming in, and that's my political opinion on that whole situation. Tighten up the borders. Don't let too many people in. We have a lot of economic problems already in our country. You know, I believe that we should really don't let too many people in. I mean, there's laws. I don't know. There's a law that, you know, they're looking to. I don't think they could. I think there's only to this day, year to date, there's been about 1,900 Syrians refugees that have been in the United States.
Legally.
Okay, so it's 1,900 legally. So, you know, it's a tough one. It's a tough one, you know, with the refugees coming in. You know, what do we do? What do we do? You know, the Bible says love your neighbor, love your foreigner, love, you know, love the people, love, feed people, clothe people, you know, give people a place to stay. That's what the Bible says. But we also, the Bible also says count the cost, you know, count the cost, be wise. So, you know, we need to be wise. America, our government needs to be wise in not making rash decisions, you know. But it is an emotional time for everybody, and I get emotional myself, you know. I kind of jump back and forth from my testimony to the problem, because then the reason why I do that is I believe that the problem or my testimony has a lot to do with the problem, and that's why I jump back and forth. I go from my testimony to the problem, and unfortunately, you know, there's a lot of problems in America today with our government. There's a lot of controversy, there's a lot of conspiracy, there's a lot of things that we're dealing with. Not only on, you know, natural eye, you know, there's definitely spiritual things that we're dealing with. And, you know, so in 2010, I became a Christian. I said the prayer of salvation, and I asked Jesus to come into my heart. Save me. Turn from my wicked ways. And follow Jesus. And keep my eyes on the cross, you know. And I think that is the answer to the Syrian refugee problem, to the fear that the American people are feeling. I think the problem is, and the solution for the problem is supernatural, that God is more powerful, and if God is for us, nobody could be against us. And, you know, I thank God today. You know, I thank God today for the freedom that I have in this country as whatever I, you know, call myself or what people call me. I'm an Arab American, ex-Catholic Muslim, you know, Irish, you know. You know, I, whatever I am, I know that God, you know, if he's for me, nothing can be against me. So, you know, I just, so after I became a Christian, 2010 to the current day, it's been a journey. It's been an interesting journey, and I think that, like I said, the answer to the solution to the problem is not the refugees coming in. It's, you know, how we're going to handle it. We have to pray for these people. We have to pray for these people. We have to pray for our borders. We have to pray for our government. We have to pray. We have to. I want my relationship to be right with God, you know. And I believe if my relationship is right with God, that, you know, he's going to keep me when fear comes my way. And he's going to help me and guide me, you know. And when I was a Muslim, before I became a Christian, you know, I didn't know these things. I didn't hear about the message of the gospel before, when I was a Muslim, until I was 28 years old. Nobody came to tell me the message of the gospel until I was 28 years old. So, I want to thank my wife. She's the one who gave me the message of the gospel that God sent her. And we've been together since 2002. And so I'm grateful today. I'm grateful today that I have an opportunity to tell the story, my testimony, the love of God that came across my life, the love of God that touched my soul, the love of God that wants to radiate to other people in this life and touch other people's lives. You know, it's the power of God. God comes in my life, changes, transforms, protects us. God's my comforter. You know, and I'm just, you know, I just thank God today. I thank God, you know, for the state that we live in, you know, and the future of what, you know, what's going to happen here in the future. And, you know, yeah.
Could you say more about ISIS and how it got started and how it became so powerful quickly?
Yeah, that's a big question. I wish I knew.
What'd your dad say?
My father said that he believed that ISIS was created by America.
What?
That's what he said.
Iran?
No. He said that they believe... That's the conspiracy that they believe. They believe that, that ISIS was an America-created group, and that ISIS is mainly made up of Europeans. They're luring the Europeans online, and they're paying them money, a lot of money, to do what they're doing.
Excuse me, when you say America, you mean a reaction to what we did, or that we formed for some reason?
I think that's what my father was talking about, forming them.
Really?
Really, that's what, and my dad, like, he's one of those CNN buffs, news, you know, he's a Sunni Muslim. That's what his response was to me. He said, I asked him, I said, how, you know, he says, no, he said this to me, he says, how do you explain this? He says, how did ISIS get so big so fast? who is behind it. Somebody is behind this that's bigger than the guy that runs the operation. I don't know his name. Yes, sir.
Educate us on the difference between Islam, Muslim, and how that caliphate and Sharia law all.
Yeah. Well, they're all the same. The Muslim religion and the Sharia law. Sharia law is a mandate that the more extreme Muslims they will you know put into effect. You know, like they're like there's you know like Sharia law is there's certain rules. Like for example, if you go to Jordan, right? It's a Muslim country, 100% Muslim. You got 3 million Palestinians in Jordan. You got 2 million Jordanians. They don't live under Sharia law there. They're all Muslim. You got maybe a couple few Christians. Syria, they're all Muslim. They don't practice Sharia law there. There's probably 10% Christians in Syria. If you go to Saudi Arabia, they practice Sharia law. Their main sect of Islam and the religion is the Wahhabi Muslims. You know Osama bin Laden? He was a Wahhabi Muslim. That's a different sect. That's a more extreme sect. Just like the Ku Klux Klan. And
It does not teach Sharia law.
It does not teach Sharia law.
So that's more of a tradition?
It's more of a tradition. It's more of man-made. You know, we're going to control you. We're going to tell you what to do. I don't think it says anywhere in the Quran that, you know, you, if you're a woman, that you're going to walk down the street and you have to have identification if you're not with your brother or your father.
There are some who say that in order to be a good Muslim, you have to be basically extreme, because that's what the Quran says. Is that just a translation?
It's a translation.
It's up to debate, I guess, among Muslims.
It is. There's two movements.
Okay.
The movement is you don't have to do that, and then there's the movement you have to do that.
Hmm. So it's in there.
It is in there.
People say you can just
it's
ignore.
All based upon interpretation, extremism, how much coffee you drank that day.
You know. Big government, big religion.
That's exactly, you know, and you know, unfortunately, yeah, that's the truth. But there's two coins, two sides of the coin.
Okay.
There's that, you know, there is that the coin where you know, you don't have to do that. Oh, who said that? That doesn't say that in the Quran. I'm like, I was Muslim for 34 years. It says it in the Quran. You know, and then there was the other side where he's like, you have to do that. It doesn't say it in the Quran. So it's like, you know, they make stuff up.
Why would some people say that you don't have to do it then?
Well, because they want to deceive you. Huh. To make you think that that's the right way. Like, for example, I'll give you an example. I was preaching to a Muslim guy not too long ago. And if you want to go pray to God as a Muslim, you have to wash yourself a certain way. Uh-huh. You have to have a certain mindset. And if you actually go to pray and you fart, okay, this is an example. It's a funny example, but it's an example, and it's the truth. And you go pray, God won't accept your prayer.
Is that?
You got to go rewash yourself. It is in the Quran.
Really?
It is. You have to go rewash yourself a certain way, and then go re-pray, so God can accept your prayer. You know, so like I asked the guy that. He said, "Where does it? You know, it doesn't say that. That's they change that." I says, they didn't change that. Like it's called wudu. It's evolution. It's a certain way you wash yourself, and you can't have any like certain thoughts. So like there's the people that say, oh, you don't have to do it. More moderate. You know, like for example, in Jordan, they don't wear the head covers. In Jordan, my mother, well, she's not my mother, but she's my stepmom. She's Jordanian Palestinian. She doesn't wear a scarf. Neither does her any of her family. Her mother does because she's elderly.
Mark, there's the Quran, there are the Sunnis. Yeah, and the Hadiths, which are the stories, and there's the sort of the explanations of the Hadiths.
The sources?
So so there are all these things that came from the Quran, mm-hmm. that are not in the Quran.
Right.
So So a lot of the interpretations of what was in the Quran came after. I mean, the whole thing was written 200 something years after.
Right.
And so forth. So I guess, you know, when people say the Quran, what's in the Quran? Well,
that's not necessarily
what was in the Quran. It was written by scholars who had said, well, this is what he really meant.
Right.
Is that right? I understand.
Well, they interpreted it. Right. Prophet Muhammad, they say that Prophet Muhammad couldn't read or write. He was illiterate. So when he was with his wife, he was a peddler. And he could not read or write. And Khadija, his wife, who was twice his age, was the one who kind of, I think, you know, took the reins there. I mean, you know, with all due respect, you know, to women.
That explains.
The Jews have 113 laws in their Bible, in the Old Testament. The Christians have the Ten Commandments. And Sharia law, would that be the laws under which the Quran lives or the Muslims live? Would it be an equivalent?
Or maybe it came from
That could be the way you could look at it. Laws that they had maybe like made up that would, you know, be kind of man-made laws. You could look at it that way. I mean, I don't even know.
The Jews have the 113 laws,
right.
And they're the Levites, and all they did was the law. And then the Christians came along, and the Christians had the Ten Commandments. They took the Ten Commandments from the Old Testament, and Christ was the fulfillment. So, and we adhere to them. I mean, we have customs and liturgies, but they were the part that was, you know, added on.
Gotcha.
But the Quran, is what rules are in there if it's not Sharia law? I mean, is it just mayhem with the ones that are... that don't have Sharia law? And I mean, is there mayhem in Jordan?
No. You know, I
and
think...
it wasn't in Turkey either for a long time.
It wasn't. There's a lot of rules. Religion is man-made.
Yeah.
Bottom line, you know, any religion is man-made. You know, so the laws that have been made up, their Sharia law is a religion put into a law. That's exactly. So there are rules in the Quran. I mean, there's actually a book that you can get that, like, there's a rule for everything. There's a rule, like, you're not even allowed to be a left-handed person if you're Muslim. Like, you're the devil if you have a left hand, if you're left-handed. They'll make you become righty. I mean, if you're really extremist. I mean, so you know what I'm saying? I mean, really. I had a cousin who was lefty, and, you know, he was like Lucifer. It was bad. I mean, they made him become a righty because he the devil was left. You know, I mean, shows you.
That's in every faith.
Is that really?
Yeah.
Oh,
my
wow.
Mother is Irish from Ireland, and she was a lefty, and she was made righty.
Okay. So,
so
you know,
I mean,
religion.
That was all believed.
Same bag of tricks, religion. My mother was a Catholic. Mm. Yes.
Question. One of the things that I run into sometimes as a minister, you know, is having to explain to people or understand the difference between extremism and non-extremism with Islam.
Right.
And my question is if the extremists and the non-extremists are supposedly peaceful, read the same book, how is the extreme ones taking it literally and the peaceful ones not taking it literally?
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
I do.
Is it the same book?
Right.
You know? Because from what we've been studying, Sharia is the ultimate goal of Islam, is to create an Islamic state.
Right.
And the army, or the way with which they do that, is through jihad.
Right.
Eliminating any opposing force against Islam. So I don't know if you can elaborate on that.
Yeah. That's a good question. It is the same book. Mm-hmm. It's the same book. They don't have different versions of the book. It's the Shiites and the extremists read the same exact book. That's one of the things that they say is a miracle of the Islam, is that the book has never been changed since it's been created. That's what they said. So the difference between the extremists they're interpreting it differently. They're, you know what I'm saying? Like, they're not. And then you have the moderate people that are, it doesn't say in the Quran to do what these guys are doing. Like, if you blow yourself up and you commit suicide, it doesn't say that in the Quran. You know, there's not, you know, so they're doing that based upon, if you do it in the name of God, that you're going to blow yourself up. And if you're doing it for the sake of God, that you're promised heaven. And
72 virgins?
Not 72. Just 14 virgins with covers, and they're nuns, and they got shotguns. That was a joke I saw on Facebook once. Like, welcome to heaven. Yes.
Are the different sects of Muslim, is it according to how the Quran is translated? And who does the translation? Who has the authority to do the translation? And then my third question, I understand in the Quran that if you're not Muslim, you're an infidel.
Right.
And infidels are to be killed, done away with. Now, that is in the Quran, correct?
So about the infidels.
It's peaceful. Hmm?
Right. The infidels?
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
So what makes a peaceful Muslim peaceful if the Quran says to do away with the infidel? I guess I asked too many questions.
No, that's because I understand where you're coming from. Well, the peace, you know, they claim to be the religion of peace, you know. And I said to my father, too, one time, and I said, you know, Dad, why is the Muslim religion is just not working? I said, you know, this, every Muslim country in the world is in uproar. I mean, really, I mean, crucifying the Christians, you know, killing each other. I don't really know where that peace is. You know, they have their expression where they always say Salaam Alaikum, you know, and that's peace be with you, and then Wa Alaikum Salaam, which is peace be back unto you. And, you know, I think it's peace to, deception. It really is. The whole religion is made up of deception. And I didn't, what was the other question that you asked?
Well, does everybody take their own interpretation, or do the sects of the Muslim depend on the interpretation of that group?
There is a combination of both. You know, you have to look at one thing, right? There's good and bad in everybody. Now, in the Muslim religion, they look a lot to scholars. Okay, like people who have doctorates and, you know, major, major degrees. It's always, we have to look to the scholars, you know. And so there is certain people in the Islamic faith in the world, in high statures, high standards, high places, that are interpreted, scholars. Sheikhs that you know, like kind of like priests, they call them sheikhs. They interpret what they interpret to their people. So they have these big organizations around the world that are key players that will interpret certain things that have influence over a large number of people. So you know that you have that, and then you have your individual interpretation, and then you have. You know, so that's really, you know, that's, does that answer your question?
Well, kind of. What about killing the infidels, though? I mean, where do you stop? Like, when you were a Muslim, or your father, what makes him not kill?
Well, here's the thing. Infidel, I think, in the Quran means somebody who does not believe in God.
Well, Allah is their God.
Right. So an infidel is a godless person. That's my what I got out of being a Muslim for 34 years. Like, for example, I was at Giant the other night in the supermarket, and a guy tapped on my shoulder at 10 o'clock at night. And he said to me, he says, "Didn't you go to the mosque?" Like, this is years ago. I didn't even know this guy. And he knew me. He says, and he said he was concerned for me. I haven't been in the mosque for 5 years. I says, "Really?" He says, "Well, I guess..." I says, "I don't even know who you are, but thanks for being concerned for me." I says, "Let me tell you about Jesus." Yes. So it turned around, like, you know, and I don't know why I got on that subject.
But then you don't fear for your own life.
I don't.
And definition of infidel.
Do you feel like other people, like, why would you feel obliged to kill any godless people then?
Right. I kind of lost my train of thought there with the infidel.
You're not answering there is really, the question that she poses is very important.
Right.
Because I don't care how you interpret the Quran.
Yeah.
If you have to get rid of the infidels, there's only one way to, there's only two ways. You either convert them or you annihilate them. That's what I understand
it is. That there's two sides of the coin there.
It's not a peaceful religion by any stretch of the imagination.
Right. That's what I was going to say. The Muslims believe, they supposedly say that they believe in the Bible. So the guy that was at Giant the other night, who tapped me on my shoulder and told me, he says that we believe in Jesus more than you believe in Jesus. This is what he told me. And I said, excuse me? I was like, wait a second here. You got it all, you know, backwards. But I, you know, so they believe, the Muslims believe in the old book, which is the Torah. They believe in the new book, which is the New Testament. They believe that, they believe in the Ten Commandments. So they believe in the continuation of the religion from Moses to Jesus to the Quran that was written. So the message of the Bible, which is Jesus dying on the cross, the message of the Bible, they don't believe that Jesus died on the cross. Okay, so they really don't believe in the message of the true Bible. So being an infidel and not being infidel, I'd be honest with you, I can't really speak for the hatred that comes from that section. And when I was a Christian, when I was a Muslim, before I became a Christian, I didn't believe in killing anybody. And I don't think my father believes in killing anybody. He's been living in America for a long time. So I think that's more of a, like a, like you were saying before, the jihad. You know, jihad means it's holy war. Okay? It's a holy war that we're in. We have to remember that. It's a holy war. It's not flesh and blood. It's spiritual things. Spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, pulling down the strongholds that you know, that try to, you know, influence us. You know what I'm saying? So that's, you know, holy war. You know, good book you could read about a Muslim, about infidels. If you want to read a good book, his name is Kamal Saleem. He wrote a book called The Blood of the Lamb and The Word of My Testimony, called The Blood of the Lamb. He was working for the PLO. He came to America, to the Bible Belts, to preach jihad. Okay? He got into a car accident, was taken in his house by Christians, or I think it was Christians and Jews, and he saw the real truth, and he became a Christian. He was going to take his life, had a gun to his head, and God spoke to him when he called out, not to Allah, which is God in Arabic. See, we have to understand one thing. The Muslim religion, it's not a, they believe in God the Father. They pray, the word Allah means God in Arabic. It's a language. So they mean God the Father. So as a Christian now, the Bible says there's no way to the Father but through Jesus Christ and the blood. There's no way to get to the Father. The Jesus is the mediator. He's the mediator between us and heaven. That's why the prayer of salvation is so important, because the prayer of salvation says, accept Jesus in your heart as your Lord and Savior. Turn from your wicked ways, regardless of what's going on. So, and you know, so that you know, that's really the true message. What remember before, my main thing was, what's the truth? What's the truth we're looking for? What the truth that I found was, is that the only power that I have is the power of the cross, the power of God, the power of redemption, the power of forgiveness, the power of, you know, turning my back from sin and moving forward. You know, that's the power that I have. When I have fear, I go to the cross. That's the solution. That's the solution for me. It's been the solution. That's what set me free. You know? And I don't know if that radiates to you guys, and I hope it does, and I pray that it does, but, you know, the Bible says who the Son sets free is free indeed. And it's a freedom that we have. We live in the land of opportunity and a land of freedom, and, you know, God has set me free. And because I don't think, if I wasn't free, I wouldn't be here right now on this podium. I'd be home and playing with my 4-year-old.
Getting back to our problem.
Yeah.
The Syrian refugees.
Right.
Coming to this state.
Yes.
Pennsylvania.
Yes.
And Wolf saying, okay, let them all in. There was a suggestion on how to vet them. There is no way that our Homeland Security is going to find out anything about any of these people.
Right.
They're just going to look at your face, and if they think you're okay, they'll let you through.
Right.
Which is absurd.
Yes.
And looking at what I see on TV, I see an awful lot of young men between the ages of 15 and 35. Mm-hmm. One statistic said there was 85% of the ones that are surging through Europe, going through Europe, are in that age group and young men.
Right.
There's no wife. There's no children attached to their leg or running around with
right.
them. So why would you want to not vet them and let them in? Whether they're good or bad,
right.
I have no problem. But I would put them in a camp.
Right.
Right there in Syria.
Yeah.
Send them lots of money and provide for them.
Sure.
I have no problem with providing for them.
Right.
I just don't want them to come here because what they're coming here to do is chaos.
Yeah.
The other trouble, somebody suggested that we should let in women and children mm-hmm. and men over 50.
Oh.
I don't see any problem with that.
Right.
But they said no. Our government said no.
Uh-huh.
And Mr. Wolf said, well, no. So what is your opinion on that?
Well, I think that I agree with you. And I feel that it's a big question. It's a lot.
Excuse me. I just have a quick comment about what you have to say, Pat. And that is, what this country was founded on immigrants.
Right.
But we had Ellis Island. Ellis Island vetted everybody who came in here. If they had any kind of disease, they were turned
right.
back. If they didn't have anything to contribute, they were turned back.
Right.
What we're seeing now is an influx of people that we don't know anything about. It's not like we can go to Syria and say, hey, Syria, Homeland Security, of which they have none.
Right.
We don't know anything about these people. There are women. Even though there's women, they have children that are being trained to shoot the infidels. So I don't see anything good about
right.
about at this time to bring them in. We are a nation of people that go to other countries as missionaries.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't understand why these people want to be dragged to a country that they're not familiar with. I don't understand why we aren't just having missionaries continue their work
right.
under some sort of protection against these ISIS fighters. And why we haven't knocked out the ISIS fighters yet is beyond me. When it's obvious that the French went over there with 20 bombs
right.
and knocked out one of their headquarters. There's something wrong with what our government is doing
Absolutely.
To fight this. And I don't think anybody in this room is un-Christian enough to save these people who are true
mm-hmm.
Refugees. But why would they want to come here? Why would they want to stay in their country and have missionaries take care of them and help them like we have done for centuries?
Right.
Well, I mean, not centuries, but a couple hundred years.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes, that's a very good point. I think that
and what other
to be in their shoes, you know, you have to look at it in their shoes. I mean,
okay.
If I was in a country that was getting blown up, I mean, and my life was threatened, and my family was threatened.
Right.
I mean, I'd be running away too. I'd be running real far.
But that's my point.
Yeah.
With your wife and children.
Right.
These guys are running away claiming to be refugees, not with a wife
right.
and children.
Young men.
So what they're doing, here's what they're doing. I was reading about this. What they're doing is they're assimilating and they're sending these refugees, and they're only letting refugees through that have family members that are already here in the United States or wherever they're sending them. So like, for example, you have Allentown, which is a couple hundred just came in there. Well, there's a Syrian population in Allentown that they already have family members there. So they are screening, you know, them for that. I don't know what their process is to screen them. You know, I mean, I know that, you know, so I know that part, you know, you know, that they're sending them, they have families already. So like, there's like, I think that's one of the prerequisites or, you know, things to get them through.
Yeah, but all these single men.
Right.
When they were living in Syria before anything happened.
Yeah.
They're living there all independently, all by themselves. Yeah. I mean, their relatives are here in Allentown.
Right, I'm not sure.
And they're living over there all by themselves.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
To the extent they're 85% of them.
Right.
What I believe that you're seeing in pictures that we see currently, which is what's happening in Europe, it's unlike what's happening here, where you see the 80, 85% young men. The people right now that are possible immigrants to the United States, and it's about 10,000 at this point, although, you know, Obama wants to admit many more.
Right.
They've already been waiting for a couple of years. They've gone through the UN process of debriefing,
yeah,
find out who they are. Then they get signed to another organization, they get debriefed again. So this initial, whatever influx, 10,000 or however many it is, have been, they're more the families, not like the people who see those pictures, which is like swarms of young men. We probably should be back in the country fighting for the country.
Right.
So it's a different population, and I think it gives us a little bit of a distorted view of
who's coming in.
Of who's coming in.
Right.
Maybe, I don't think it is unwise to be worried about what happens in the next wave. I think that's what, instead of panicking now, I think we should think about, you know, making sure that things are in place.
Yes.
Make sure that they're properly vetted because.
Absolutely.
Because these people, before the whole crisis really blew up, thanks to our lack of leadership in this country, there were people that were already trying to get out. And they're like the people from Iran when with the fall of the Shah. I knew many Iranians who came here to flee from
right.
Ayatollah Khomeini. And I think that the people that get out initially, they really just want to escape being murdered, you know, and escape with their families. So there are a lot more families in that group, and that is what they, as you said, they try to place them. And they don't say, I'm going to place these people in the United States. They say, where do these people have families? Are they a family in Germany? A family in, and then they try to contact the family, see if they'll accept them. So they may or may not even get in. The vetting right. process isn't perfect, but it's not just they show up and they say, hey, are you a terrorist? There's a lot more to it than that. Beyond that, I think there is a concern, as you know, ISIS has promised to infiltrate and plant terrorists. Well, good grief, the Sarnev brothers, the Boston bombers, came here as kids. And then they went back to Chechnya and they got radicalized.
Right.
So who saw that coming? Well, the Russians, if we did.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You're right, and I agree with a lot of what you just said there. And, you know, the American government definitely has to kind of, you know, we need to pray for our government. It's urgent. You know, it's a call for prayer. It's a message to, you know, the government. You know, if you look back and you see where, you know, what our government done, I mean, we're supposed to be we the people, you know, and we the people elect our officials. And, you know, and unfortunately, it shows you it shows you the mindset of the American people who's in our office now. Okay, there's your mindset. I mean, you know, there's no, you know, and you know, if you go back to look at if you go back to Russia, what happened in Afghanistan. You know, I mean, our country armed Osama bin Laden, gave him money, and trained him. That's our country did that. I mean, if that doesn't speak volumes, that, you know, we obviously don't know, or our government, you know, I didn't have anything to do with those decisions. I didn't, you know, vote for us to send arms and train Osama bin Laden. I didn't see any, you know, that wasn't in the news. You know, and then you have Obama on the news in the last couple days, and he said that, you know, his CIA and his secret services gave him false information about ISIS. And that's why he hasn't done anything about it. So the answer, I mean, that's what's in the news right now. False information? I mean, are you serious? You're the president of the United States, you know? So that blew me away when, you know, I mean, so, you know, you're right. What is our government doing? Why hasn't they jumped all over ISIS yet? Why haven't they blown them out of the water? I mean, they're beheading people, and they're killing people left and right, and they're growing larger every day. You know what it is? It's there's an epidemic, and that, you know, the American people need to stand up, and we need to do something about it, you know? And unfortunately, with all the stringent policies and the healthcare, you know, that's going up, and the taxes that are increasing, and, you know, and who has time for that? Unless you run for office, and you give your life to it, and, you know, even then, you know. You know, we need to have people in office that are, you know, educated, that have strong security backgrounds.
That love America.
That love America. That love Jesus. You know? That's what we need in our country. You know, God-fearing people that are gonna stand for the truth. You know.
Well, I definitely agree with that. I would say the problem is the people that are in ISIS are not running around with uniforms that say ISIS.
Yeah.
So the difficulty is knowing who's in ISIS and what they're doing. You know, they're not wearing uniforms. They're not marching in columns. They're blending in with the rest of the people.
That's right.
They're ready to take some action.
That's right.
So how do you find them without killing a lot of innocent people at the same time? I think that is the problem.
That's a big problem. I agree with you. And you know what? This has been going on for years. It's not just the Syrians. It's not ISIS. I mean, you go back into, you know, what happened, you know, 9/11. I mean, even back at the Chechnya war with Russia. I mean, you got Chechnya. I mean, you know, do you understand the people, the war that was happening in Chechnya between Russia? They're called, I don't know if anybody heard of them, called lone wolves. They're secret service people from Chechnya that are like our secret force. I mean, they were getting across our border. I mean, you have the, you know, the regardless of what you do, you know, there's always going to be a problem. It's how you handle the problem. How we handle the problem. It's the solution. What's the solution? You know? And that's, I can't echo that enough. And whatever I'm here for today, that I'm here, but I can't echo that enough. The solution of the problem is that we need to look to Jesus, to the cross. I can't emphasize on and highlight that as enough, because that is the only source of where our power is going to come from. That's the only source where we're going to overcome the ISIS. It's the only source that we're going to overcome, you know, fear. And we are not going to live in fear. As American people, I'm not going to live in fear. I don't know about y'all, but I hope you all don't live in fear either. But you know what? Life's too short. And, you know, and the price has already been paid. We already have a free ticket into heaven. And you know what? And that's all, you know, to answer every question, that's the answer to every question. Kill the infidels? No. They need Jesus. Pray for them. You know? The young men that are coming in and they have no families? Pray for them that they find Jesus and they'll be ministers and they'll be evangelists and they'll travel back to their own country and they'll set people free and they'll pray for their own people. Well, let's pray for that. So the solution is we have to call upon the name of Jesus. We have to have a right relationship with God. It's not about religion. It's not about hypocrisy. It's not about rhetoric. It's not about lies. It's what's the truth. And the truth of the matter is, the truth is Jesus said, I'm the truth and the way. And, you know, and I can't emphasize that enough. The truth is Jesus. He's the truth. What's truth on this life? You know, and you know, I just thank God today. I thank God for this opportunity to, you know, to be here. I appreciate it. I pray for peace in this town and all y'all. And I thank you for all your questions. And God bless you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.